Now, I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, we didn't get quite the most complete version of American history. And some of the things we were taught were simply myths. To fill in some of the blanks and to help us understand the nation's long debate over citizenship and equal protection under the law, we turn to two prominent historians, Annette Gordon Reed, who teaches at Harvard, and Eric Foner of Columbia University. Professor Gordon Reed, Professor Foner, so nice to see both of you. Thank you for talking with me. Professor Gordon Reed, if I can start with you. I think we like to think of citizenship as this very straightforward thing. You are or you aren't, but it seems like it's actually been quite shifting over the years. Why don't you begin for me with a little history of how we thought about the citizenship question from the very beginning?
Well, certainly at the beginning of the Republic, the notion that everybody who lived here was a citizen was not the case, because obviously there were African Americans, most of whom were enslaved, who were not considered citizens of the new United States, nor could they become. Could black people come to the country? The Naturalization Act of 1790 said it had to be free white people who could come and become citizens of the United States. It took a long time, people who were not enslaved, African Americans who were not enslaved, were not considered full citizens. Their citizenship was second class. There was first class and second class citizenship, which you didn't have before. Obviously, the 14th Amendment was designed to bring black people into citizenship. But we know, even after that was a technical legality, a technically legal thing, it still didn't exist. Equal citizenship did not exist. And it took until the 60s.
Professor Foner, if you would jump in on this.
These questions have been contested ever since the beginning of our republic, and they're still being fought out. I mean, every day we are debating on the border between the United States and Mexico who should be entitled to American citizenship, and of course, what rights come with being a citizen. In the early days of the republic, and in fact, well into the 20th century, let's say white women born in the United States were certainly considered citizens, and yet they didn't enjoy anywhere near the same rights as men. So being a citizen is not necessarily directly related to enjoying equal privileges, equal rights, etc.
Talk to me a little bit about the ramifications of the fact that we keep having this debate, never fully being able to clarify what it means to, you know, be a citizen.
That basic contradiction between liberty and slavery has fed through American history. Slavery does not exist anymore, fortunately, but the idea that some people are more deserving than others of enjoying the full rights of being American is still out there. Even though we pride ourselves on being a democracy, there are many people who feel some Americans are more equal than others, so to speak.
You've talked about reframing the Reconstruction so that it's understood correctly. How is it misunderstood today, and how would you reframe it?
But for many years, until not that long ago, Reconstruction was seen as a period of just vindictiveness by the North toward the white South, of corruption, misgovernment. The giant mistake, according to this view, was giving African American men the right to vote, because in that interpretation, black men were just not capable of exercising that right properly in a democracy. And this was a justification for the Jim Crow South. It was a justification for the elimination of black voting, which took place around 1900, more or less. Today, I think we see Reconstruction far differently. It was a period of a biracial democracy, the first time in American history that large numbers of African Americans had the right to vote, to hold office. It was really a major step forward for democracy, and the tragedy is not that it was attempted, but that it was overthrown by violence, by corruption, and other things. So the point really is just history matters. What we think about history matters today. It's not just a arcane academic subject.
Part of my book, I found my great-great-grandfather's registration in 1867, Texas, voting. And then by 1870, as you know, Eric, Reconstruction's over in Texas. And I think about what that must have meant to him to be able to do that and to think about participating in society and have that just cut off. And then have people later on, as you say, with the history, making it seem like his participation was some huge mistake and some terrible thing that happened to the country.
The debate we're having today, how all of this about, you know, both the color of the skin and the and how that sort of bears on your access to citizenship, how does that play out today?
There's a sort of a contradiction between using anti-immigrant sentiment as a political weapon, and it has been shown that in some circumstances it can be a very effective political weapon. And yet, on the other hand, the labor needs of the society are there. Who is going to pick all of those crops out in California that the entire country relies on, you know, for their dinner table? Native-born Americans are not likely to be taking those jobs. Everybody says our immigration system is broken. We have millions of people here with no documentation. What is going to become of them? Their children born in the United States are citizens because of the 14th Amendment. So you have families, some members of whom can be just kicked out of the country, others can't. I think the one thing we can agree on is that this system has to be fixed in some way. Right now, it is totally dysfunctional.
Professor Gordon Reed, final question to you. We've been in this conversation framing this to some degree as a black-white issue, but actually, sadly, the history of exclusion in America kind of covers a lot of people. How does this play out ultimately, do you think?
I do think that broadening this, making this not just about blacks and whites and Asians and others, is really, really important. And I think there are signs that these groups are forming common cause, understand that they're fighting this notion of white supremacy that doesn't just affect black people and Asian people, it affects white people too. I mean, it limits all of us in ways. So I prefer to be hopeful about things. History, you know, we don't want to see that we're sort of skipping towards some inevitable, wonderful, you know, end, but we have made progress.
Professor Annette Gordon Reed, Professor Eric Foner, so nice to talk to both of you. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you.